Thank you very much for inviting me to give this talk on systemic lupus erythematosus, antiphospholipid syndrome, and pregnancy. So I will start with a very short clinical case just to see what you would do if you have a patient who is 30 years old, no previous pregnancy. She is referred before the pregnancy because she wants to be pregnant. She has a systemic lupus erythematosus with cutaneous and articular involvement, very simple. She's on hydroxychloroquine, HCQ. She has anti-DNA antibodies, and anti-SM antibodies, which means she has lupus indeed. What would you do? What will you say? So you are obliged to speak. Otherwise, yes, stay at this line and you will eat at 5, 6. We don't know. So, you will refer her to Guillermo, to Estibaliz? Ah, no more slides. So we wait for the slide in the meantime. Okay, so I need my slide, okay? So I will suggest something. For me, I think the four boxes are very easy to use. So you should think and you should check the four boxes. Your patient, she has lupus, you must make sure that the lupus is inactive and it will be very simple. You must check if she has antiphospholipid antibodies or even syndrome, but that you would know. You must check the anti-SS antibody, but you can see that the small cross, it's not very important. And you must check the treatment to make sure that she has all the treatment she needs and that also she will stop what she has to stop for the pregnancy. So if you think with these four boxes, you won't forget anything and it's more simple. So we'll start with the lupus and you will see that it's quite easy finally. You have this nice study, a prospective observational study performed in the US and the Canada. Yes, I will do like that. They included patients who were pregnant with lupus and the pregnancy was ongoing at 12-week gestation and excluded those with multiple pregnancy, diabetes, hypertension, proteinuria over 1 gram per day, high creatinine, and prednisone, which is very high for us, but not so high, it seems, for them. But they excluded these patients with active SLE. Briefly, I will just show that. They published 385 patients with lupus, with a mean age of 31 years old. A third had a past history of renal manifestations, and interestingly, only 63% were treated with hydroxychloroquine. And I think, I'm not the only one, that the number of patients on hydroxychloroquine is a good means to know the quality of care of the patients. If usually in Guillermo's patients, my patient, Fred Ducio, maybe probably Bordeaux, it's almost 100%. It should be over 90, 91, 95. It should be over. When it's so low, it means something is wrong with these patients. Anyway, among these patients with an ongoing pregnancy at 13 week gestation, 1 out of 5 had a complicated pregnancy. And if you look at this slide, you can see that patients with lupus anticoagulant or those with antihypertensive drugs and who were Hispanic and non-Caucasian, the black patient in the US, had a high rate of complication, 58%. But when they have no lack and they have no this, the rate of complications is much lower. Okay, and so I'm in the box of the lupus, but already I'm speaking about antiphospholipid antibodies. So the what you can remember from this slide is that the prognosis is quite good if you don't have the antiphospholipid antibody, the LAC, which is the most severe one, and if you don't have hypertension and are not black and Hispanic. Regarding the flares, as you can see, mild flares 10% per trimester. Severe one, very low, 2 to 3% per trimester. And what do you learn from that? It's that you have few severe flares if at the beginning the patients are quite well controlled. And I think that if those patients had been on hydroxychloroquine, the numbers of flares would have been even lower. This is our experience in France. From this cohort, they looked at the kidney involvement. And they showed that if you have no history of renal manifestation, never any kidney involvement, the patient I showed you at the beginning, less than 2% of new kidney involvement during the pregnancy or because of the pregnancy. If you had one, but your patient is in complete remission, it's 8%. And if she's only in partial remission, it increases to 20%. So what do you do with all this information? You need to explain to your patients that they should be inactive before starting the pregnancy in order to avoid all these complications. Okay, this is very important. And then you should check the antiphospholipid antibodies, especially the LAC, lupus anticoagulant. And indeed, that's all for lupus, because I think usually we can manage pretty easily this part. We can discuss later. Antiphospholipid antibodies or antiphospholipid syndrome is much more tricky. You all know normally the clinical classification criteria for antiphospholipid syndrome. You need one clinical plus one biological. For the clinical, it's either thrombosis, consecutive spontaneous abortions, 3, before 10 weeks gestation, I'll come back to that later, fetal death defined after 10 weeks gestation, or prematurity due to placental insufficiency, mainly preeclampsia, HELLP syndrome. So you need at least one of them, and you need the antibodies. You have 3 antibodies to check, anticardiolipin, anti-beta-2, GP1, and lupus anticoagulant, and you must confirm that they are still positive after 12 weeks. So if you have both, you have antiphospholipid syndrome. If let's say syndrome, well, something we don't see very often in the presentation or the articles, but I think it's a very important point, is that antiphospholipid syndrome doesn't mean anything because you have different phenotypes. And it's not at all the same to have the third trimester miscarriages than to have the fetal death or the preeclampsia at 22-week gestation. And it's even more severe to have thrombotic events, venous, or even more severe, arterial. And indeed, the patient with arterial thrombotic events often have some of these features that go together in general. So it will be the valvulopathy, livedo, I will show you a picture. You have thrombosis in the microvessels in the kidneys, so you have hypertension, you have a lot of antibodies, and you may develop the severe form, the catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome. So if your patient is pregnant and she's in this group, it's not at all the same as if she's in this one. So the livedo is like this. It's not normal because the pattern is not complete. Something is missing here, here, here. You should have a cycle everywhere. And this is another example, and it's also pathological because it's on the trunk. It's not usual in this place. So this is the livedo. Back to the pregnancy. You have your antiphospholipid syndrome or antibodies, and you have 2 different conditions. And for the first one, I have only one slide. It's the same since 2005, because nothing very new from this one, which was a Cochrane review. And they say that for early miscarriages, the studies are not good, and this is still true, and that, in fact, for that, you should give heparin plus aspirin, and it improves the condition. but that usually you don't see these patients when you are in internal medicine or in rheumatology, because they usually don't have lupus, no thrombosis, nothing. So they are mainly seen by gynecologists, and they are not very severe. This is totally different, the second and third trimester, mainly the second, I would say. And my slides are named Take Care, because this, you must be aware that something might happen that you did not plan or expected. So back to the PROMISE study, the study from the US and Canada. And at the time of this publication, they looked at the antiphospholipid antibodies patients, those with antiphospholipid biology, not necessarily syndrome. 144 patients. When the lupus anticoagulant is not there, only 3% of obstetrical complications. I think it's like the healthy pregnant patients. But when you have this antibody, it increases to 39%. You can see that it's a huge difference. So the morbidity is driven by this antibody. And indeed, if you look at the anticardiolipin antibody, the anti-beta-2-GP1 antibodies, it doesn't change anything. So the conclusion of this slide is that you must be very careful if your patient has lupus anticoagulant, once again. And with the same study, the same patients, they saw that with the past history of thrombosis, even though those patients are usually more treated because they have two low molecular weight heparins per day, plus aspirin, compared to those with obstetrical outcome. I will come back to that later. Despite this, they have much more adverse obstetrical outcomes, and this is more or less the same for lupus. So you must be careful when you have patients with APL, APS, who wants to be pregnant, and when she's followed by you, because she has thrombosis, SLE, and the true antiphospholipid syndrome, I would say. Something else, it's the fetal death. The fetal death, we have studied mostly in our centers, but 65 women with such a complication of antiphospholipid syndrome, so at least one fetal death by patient. It was frequently the first manifestations, but not always. In some patients, the APS was not recognized before because of another manifestations. Lupus anticoagulant was very frequent, and usually it occurs around 24 weeks gestation. And what was the most interesting is that I go back to the classification criteria. So by definition, all our patients were with a fetal death because they entered in the study like that. 38% had a preeclampsia at some times during their pregnancies. 43% had a thrombosis. I don't remember the number, but 40% also had SLE. But only one patient had presented once in her life the three spontaneous abortions. So this is another disease. Something else, take care, because the HELLP syndrome, the obstetrical complications, occur early in the pregnancy. And if you have an obstetrician with a patient with a pain here, everybody, all obstetricians in the world at 32-week gestation will think of preeclampsia, HELLP syndrome, will look carefully at the blood pressure, the proteinuria, the platelets, etc. When it occurs at 21-week gestation or even 19-week gestations, no obstetrician will think about that. And the patient may have a delayed diagnosis and a worse prognosis because of that. So it's very important to know that the complications are much earlier than usually for the obstetricians. Okay, something else. I can show a clinical case if we have time later, but some patients may present with catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome because of the pregnancy or the end of the pregnancies. This is, in this case, they published three cases plus review of the literature with 15 cases in the total. And it's catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome means that you have microthrombosis in at least three organs in less than 1 week with antiphospholipid antibodies, of course, and sometimes with the proof in the histopathology when you can do it. In this study, with 15 cases in total, what you can see is that many patients had presented HELLP syndrome before, and you can see also that the prognosis is terrible, with half of the mother who died. And so we reported our experience on 13 cases, and what is really interesting is that it's almost always the same. Your patient is known with an APS. You give the treatment. Despite this, early in the pregnancy, she presents HELLP syndrome. Then you stop the pregnancy. You need to save the mother. And because she will deliver the baby, she doesn't have to stop aspirin. You have to stop, at least for a short time, low molecular weight heparin. And then she improved after the delivery. But then, in the days or the 2 weeks following, she might present a different picture which fulfills the criteria for CAP syndrome and can be very severe. So you have to know that and to follow her very carefully after the delivery, to restart the treatment very soon and to add steroids, IVIG, or I don't know what, if you see that something is getting wrong. We had no mortality in the mother, including because we made the diagnosis earlier, I think, than before, because we know this syndrome better now, but also because in some cases they had a heart support, I don't know, ECMO in English, ECMO, okay. So take care if you have a patient with a known APS and if she develops HELLP syndrome despite the treatment, you have to be very careful. So this is it for antiphospholipid syndrome. Now, the anti-SSA antibody, the RO antibody. Everybody knows that, and everybody in the world, I think, knows that you must check the heart of the baby to see the congenital heart block. We will discuss that. This syndrome requires anti-SSA antibodies, plus or less, enfin, plus or minus, anti-SSP antibodies. It's mainly dermatological and cardiac. I will. Cutaneous manifestation. I start with. So the risk is 1% in your pregnant patient with connective tissue diseases. The risk is 1%. Okay. The cutaneous manifestations. It's not very severe. It's like this. It mimics the same as subacute cutaneous lupus, which, by the way, is also associated with anti-SSA antibodies. So this is like that, or here, classically around the eyes, on the face, or like this, it can be present at birth, or like that, sometimes very severe, but as you can see, everything will disappear. This is the same baby, girl now. Okay, so everything goes away and it's not severe. The severe one is the congenital heart block, the CHB. So the risk is around 1%, usually discovered between 16 and 24 week gestations, usually permanent and complete from the beginning, and on healthy hearts. Otherwise, the heart is usually fine, and mostly in healthy women, meaning usually we don't know the woman has the anti-SSA antibodies. And usually the diagnosis is performed when you do the usual ultrasounds during the pregnancy, and you can see around 22 week gestation in France that it's very slow, like here, but the auricula is very normal. Okay, this is normal for a baby, fetus. Oh yes, I will quit that. And for many years, we have given fluorinated steroids when we diagnosed a CHB. The idea was to reduce the inflammation, to improve the outcome, to avoid mortality later in life, to avoid pacemaker, to avoid late onset cardiomyopathy, etc., etc. The rationale was very smart. But in fact, when we checked in the different cohort, there is no efficacy at all of this treatment. in none of all the things I said, nothing. And there is adverse events, because we are speaking of low dose, but here you give usually the equivalent of 20 milligrams of steroids for all the pregnancy when you have this diagnosis, or at least for weeks. So in a pregnant patient who is already sometimes with some overweight or who is prone to have stress, it's not very good. So, as a point is important, I think, is the ultrasound monitoring. So, if you interviewed people going to a congress on pregnancy and connective tissue diseases, the vast majority will say, I'm doing ultrasound from 16-week gestation to 28. This is the majority. And they say, I'm doing it every 2 weeks or every week. It depends. Some did it even more frequently. So everybody, almost everybody, knows or wants to perform the screening. And so I have a slide, which I think is important, but is controversial, but I don't know why. So we do one ultrasound, let's say, every 2 weeks, between 16 and 24 week gestations. So if you take 100 patients with anti-SSA antibodies, you perform 500 ultrasounds. With these 500 ultrasounds, you find one with CHB. Okay? Usually, you find it around 22-week gestations, but anyway, in France, I think the same in Spain, you have normal ultrasounds around this term. So you will know it anyway. And what do you do at 22-week gestations, or even 18, with a CHB, if I tell you that you shouldn't treat them? You do nothing. You won't take out the baby at that time. You have nothing to do except waiting. So you performed in your 100 patients 500 ultrasounds, you discovered one CHB, and you did nothing. So I'm asking, why are we doing all that? I don't know. And you will see a very small part of the CHB, because here are the mothers in our cohort of CHB. The vast majority, they have nothing. A quarter, they can fulfill the classification criteria for something, but usually, this is done only when we discover the CHB. And this was not known before, and they were not followed. I think only, let's say, 15% were known to have the antibody and could have been followed. So you miss the vast majority of the patients anyway. Just a slide, because we discussed that yesterday. There is data saying that maybe hydroxychloroquine could prevent the CHB. I'm a little bit involved in that. I love hydroxychloroquine, but anyway, I'm not totally convinced that it's so efficient. But we'll see. Finally, the treatments. So the treatments, all this starts with the preconception counseling. This is very important, but it's always the same when you speak of pregnancies. You need to speak of preconception counselings. You need to recognize the contraindications. That's not so frequent now. In most of the cases, we can allow the pregnancy. As we said, you check your boxes. So lupus, antiphospholipid antibody, anti-SS antibody. You check the thyroid. You immunize your patients. You know that you should immunize against influenza, pertussis, measles, and rubella if she's not immunocompromised. You need to adapt the treatment and to stop some treatment, to give folic acid. And all that, the patient only worry whether she will give lupus to her child. She wants to know that. So even if she doesn't ask, you can reassure her that nothing will happen like that and that the genetic is not so strong in lupus. So in practice, you have a very nice guidelines regarding the treatment you can use, not only in lupus, but in general in rheumatology, you can use that. And all these treatments, you can use them. Steroids, the minimal dose, only if you really need that. And this, I will go back to this treatment. But all these treatments should be stopped before the pregnancy in order to make sure that, well, because it's dangerous, but also because you need to wait a little bit to make sure that the patient is still fine, still inactive with the change of treatment you made. For Coumadin and ACE inhibitor, you can make the change only when she's pregnant. You don't need to do it before. You wait until the pregnancy. But all that will have to be stopped anyway during the pregnancy. You also have recommendation regarding lupus and antiphospholipid syndrome in pregnant patients, which are pretty useful. So, in a practical way, you have a patient with lupus. She's pregnant. So that's very fine if she is inactive for at least 6 months, 12 months if it's renal, it depends on many things. SLE means hydroxychloroquine, so she should be on a hydroxychloroquine, and it also means that she should take it. We measure the levels in France, but you should convince her to take it. The steroids, frequently, yes, if lupus, but if she's fine without steroids, you don't need to add that for the pregnancy, and you need to have the lowest dose. Lowest is 5 milligrams, but even lower is better. And when you need an immunosuppressant, it's usually azathioprine or more and more tacrolimus. Now, I'm going back. Now you have APS. So two situations. For APS, it can be only thrombotic or non-thrombotic. So thrombotic, outside of the pregnancies, it's Coumadin usually. When they are pregnant, what do you do? Yes? So you wait the pregnancy, and then you stop Coumadin, and you replace it by 2 low molecular weight heparin per day, plus aspirin. And if she has only obstetrical APS, she's usually outside of the pregnancy on aspirin. You add low molecular weight heparin if she takes the plane, etc. And when she's pregnant, you add the low molecular weight heparin, but prophylactic dose. Okay? And in APS, there is maybe a place for hydroxychloroquine, but we don't know yet. We don't have any proof, real proof. And possibly a place for the steroids in some cases, refractory cases, with a small publication, but in a good journal, but not totally convincing. Finally, the management is